Hi, this is Richard Hall here, and welcome along to the night sky. Just want to get my laptop on. I've got that right. Okay. Anyway, as I was saying, that's me there. This is the night sky, and I've also got Kay with me as well. And we're going to be talking about the signs in the sky at the moment. So let's make a start. If you were to go out in the early evening and look due north, the sky is looking fairly barren to what it did in the winter sky when we had all the magnificent Milky Way stretching across the sky. Now it's quite barren, but the most notable thing, if you look out, is what we call the Great Square. And there it is, for those of you watching it on TV, and there's in fact lots and lots of interesting things. We may be talking about some of these later on or in a week or so's time, looking at some of the other objects there, all right? But there's also, when people come out to Stonehenge and we're teaching people the stars, we take people out and we pick out, one of the things we do is pick out the constellations. These are patterns in the sky, all right? And people often get quite bemused at the patterns appear to bear very little resemblance to the figure. Now, there's a very famous constellation right here for those of you who can see it on TV. Now, can you make out what that is? You see? Now, I'll bring up a figure to show you what it is. And it is, of course, the constellation of Aquarius. All right? And of course, you might say, well, how on earth do they see a man pouring water out of an urn? Well, it's actually, even so, it's actually supposed to be God. Now, we're looking at all the constellations down here in the southern hemisphere. Everything appears upside down because all these traditions come from the northern hemisphere. So let's turn around. That's what he looks like, right? That's what Aquarius looks like. And if you're not sure, I'll just take him away for a moment for those watching on TV. Oh, can you see the man? No. And see, the reason for this is that these ancient constellations were not named because they look like something. They were named actually for their symbolism. And Aquarius is so called not because it looks like a man pouring water out of an urn. It's actually supposed to be God, as I mentioned earlier. It's because when those stars first rose up in the dawn sky 5,000 years ago, it held the onset of the rainy season. God was about to pour water down on the earth. Another famous constellation is Leo the Lion. But again, it's called a lion, not because it looks like a lion in the sky, but when those stars rose up in the dawn 5,000 years ago, it marked the hottest time of the year. And along the Nile Valley at that time, the lions would come in from the wilderness and would prey upon the domestic flocks. It was a warning to the people, the lions are coming. And if you look up there, you'll find there's vast numbers of birds and animals. And if you turn time backwards, you'll find that when those stars rise up in the dawn, first of all, well, lo and behold, that species will very shortly migrate into the area. Now, all of this works because as we orbit around the sun, we experience the same seasons in the same part of the Earth's orbit. So when we're winter or summer, we're at exactly the same spot in our orbit as we were last summer. So consequently, every season, every month of the year has got its own pageant of stars rising up in the dawn. Right? Now, of course, our ancestors didn't know anything about stars rising up or the Earth going around the sun and so on. But what they did realise is, hey, when that particular star rose up, this was going to happen down here on Earth. And there's something also that's very special about the night sky, which sets it apart from everything else in our sky. First of all, the stars to our ancestors appear to be immortal. Generation after generation saw the same familiar stars. But they were also untouchable. But furthermore, it appears that the stars were seen as signs in the sky. They were the signs from the gods. And that's where our word heaven comes from, the heavens above, that realm which is both immortal and untouchable by mortal beings. And to test it out, all you have to do, if you go out one night and say you went out tonight and timed what time a star rose or set and did exactly the same thing from the following evening, you'd find it rises or sets 4 minutes earlier than it did the night before. and that's due to that motion of the Earth around the Sun. So night by night, a star rises earlier and earlier, eventually first appearing in our morning sky, then it moves into the evening sky, and then it disappears altogether. Well, it's still out there, of course, but it's in our daytime sky. Then it reappears in the dawn sky. And our ancestors saw this cycle of birth, life, death, and the resurrection. And right now, if you go out in the early evening and have a look, and you look out towards the sort of the northeast, you will see one of the most famous signs in the sky. And that sign, of course, is Matariki. And this is one of the most important signs in the sky, but we'll talk about that very shortly when we come back. At the moment, we're going to have a little tiny piece of music for you. Hi, this is Richard, and you're back with the night sky. Now, we were a little bit earlier, we were talking about the signs in the sky. And of course, the most important signs in the sky are those that lay along the zodiac. And the reason for that, in case you didn't know, is the zodiac are the constellations that lay along the path of the sun, all right? And the moon and the planets in our sky, the plane of the solar system. And each month, the sun and the moon, or the full moon, that is, will move from one sign to another. Right? But we were mentioning a little bit earlier, one of the most famous signs in the sky, of course, down here. And that is, of course, Matariki. Right? So let's have a look at that in the sky. So if you look out towards the east, this is the pattern of stars that you will see. Right? And Matariki, people are often surprised down here. Matariki has been important for people around the world. Now, this shouldn't surprise you, really, because if a star or a group of stars rise up at a particular time, which marks a major seasonal change, that's going to be important to people around the world. And the tradition of using Matariki to begin the year actually goes back thousands and thousands of years into ancient Europe and Asia. Because at that time, if we go back about 5,000 years, it marks the spring equinox. And for that was the most important day of the year for people living in the Northern Hemisphere. It marked the return of life on Earth following the harsh Northern Hemisphere winter, the restoration of food supplies, the lambing season. This was truly a time to celebrate. Right? And for most countries, this marks the beginning of the year. And great temples like the Parthenon and so on around the world, they actually align up with the rising of the Matariki. Of course, in Europe, they don't call it Matariki. They call it the Seven Sisters, or the Pleiades is what they're called by. All right. However, they're also known as the Hen and Chicks. And the reason for that is that when those stars rise up, that was a time to sail. It meant that's when the waters and the weather was going to be favourable. All right. So it's very, very important, right? And so from about, for at least 5,000 years, these seven sisters have been herald the new year and the opening of the sea lanes. Then 4,500 years ago, the migrations into the Pacific began. And those people carried this tradition with them. So to this day, the rising of those stars is known as herald the beginning of the new year. And of course, the stars appear upside down and they mean Matariki, which means little eyes. Now, the wonderful thing about it is you'll know about Matariki and you have to get up and see it in the dawn. That's when it was important. Of course, because of the fact that we're on the other side of the world and also the fact that there's slow changes in calendar, rising of Matariki down here occurs close to the midwinter, all right? And when you get up, you can see it in the dawn. Well, if you've got really experienced eyes, you can see it, but most people lose it quite quickly, right? But what happens at this time of the year, those very same stars that rise up in the dawn at time of Matariki, midwinter, rise up in our evening sky. So now is the opportunity really to have a study of these stars. Okay, so for those of you who can see it, it's Matariki and Puanga, but as you may know, for many tribes, Puanga is actually used instead of Matariki. Isn't that right, Kay?
Yes, that is right. But if you ask any astronomer, you will find that they're all using Puanga. Puanga is a first magnitude star. That means it's pretty clear, even when you've got a bit of light around, isn't it, Richard?
Oh, yes.
And so it rises about 20 minutes ahead of Matariki. So no matter which group you're with, actually probably the experts were spotting Puanga and then casting their eyes, sort of scanning across, because the part of your eye that sees these things more clearly is the bits on the edge, low light conditions. So you actually, it pops out bright if you just scan the horizon, but if you go back and look directly at it, disappears again.
That's right. And that's what I found. It is really handy because Puanga, which I also know as the star Rigel in Orion, even in a dawn sky, you can see it quite easy. Well, Matariki, because it is a cluster of fainter stars, is actually, unless you're very experienced, it's very difficult to actually spot. All right. So Puanga is the first one that we actually look for. Now, what it's actually said was at the time of Matariki, as we look around the sky, we see, as it was believed in the ancient traditions and beliefs, the universe as it was first formed. And all the most important signs in the sky are wrapped around the horizon at that time. Well, let's have a look at those bright stars going from Matariki, and then we go backwards, and there seems to be a row of stars descending towards the horizon. And these were known as the Stairway of Tawhaki. Kay?
Yeah, Tawhaki was kind of the chief who was the perfect ideal of a chief. He did everything correctly, and he was very tapu. All chiefs were very tapu. You didn't mess with them or where they sat or anything like that. But Tawhaki was the example, and he's climbing the stairway to heaven, which is the stairway of knowledge. Now, if you go into many meeting houses, you will find the stairway in the woven panels on the side, and you will see the same pattern going up, and that's the stairway of knowledge, gradually building on previous knowledge.
Well, that's looking out at those particular stars there, but also, and this is the important thing, as different from, like, if you take like European constellation, a constellation is a constellation, that's what it is. But with Māori, the constellations or group of stars could mean different things at different times of the year. And those same stars which you mark out the stairway also mark the location of three of the great posts in the sky.
Yeah, there are four posts altogether, and three of them are on one side and one is on the other side. And these are the posts which are holding up heaven, and they're also holding up Rangi later on.
That's right. Well, as Kay just mentioned, there are actually four posts. That's the three posts, one under his shoulder, right, each shoulder, one under the neck, and the other one was underneath his hips, which actually bent under the weight. Well, to see that, we have to look round the other side of the sky. And if we sweep around, we'll see this group of stars. And there's the bent post.
Yeah, this is the bent post, which is bent under the weight of Rangi's hips. It's also known as the Fishhook of Maui. And if you go back to Northern Hemisphere, say you went back to Hawaii, just anywhere north of the equator, then you will find that the fishhook is up the right way. It's not upside down as a fishhook here. Wouldn't catch much this way round. So it's the bent post holding up Rangi here.
And for those of you who are not sure, what the fishhook is actually, we would know it as it's the tail of the scorpion in Scorpius. All right? That's what those particular stars are. Well, it's also, those posts represent the house, Kay.
Yes, they do. And according to tradition, according to the stories, the house was built by the gods in the sky and then copied on earth. So this, if you want your astronomical basic textbook, this is it. This teaches you how to understand astronomy. That's right, isn't it, Richard, you look at the posts? Right.
Yeah, and the posts are, as for those of you who are watching this on TV, you can see they are actually stars in the sky. Right?
But they're also representing the solstices and the equinoxes.
Absolutely, yeah. Mm. They're not just random things in the sky. They actually mark where the sun rises at a solstice or an equinox. So the central one, which is Tauturu, right, is absolutely due east, and it marks where the sun rises at an equinox. Right? Matariki, at the moment, is the other post, and that's marking the winter solstice. And if we go down the other end, Pukawara, that is marking where the sun rises at the summer solstice. So you see, they're not just names in the sky. These have got importance, great importance. I had to remind people, this knowledge was so important to our ancestors. You know, because if you sailed at the wrong time, or you planted your seeds at the wrong time, you were in trouble, you know. So this is pretty vital.
Just pointing out here too that when you talk about the sacred time for these things, when the tohunga would have been announcing that such an event had happened, it was in the early morning. And that's almost universal. I mean, if you go through Europe and look at Druid tradition, something else, you'll find that it was in the morning, was the sacred time.
Well, if you look along the southern horizon, I was talking about a little bit earlier on, was that during the winter, the beautiful Milky Way comes overhead. Well, at this time of the year, it's actually laying along the horizon. The brightest parts are running all along the southern horizon. And because most of the bright stars are there, we've got all these bright stars laying along the southern horizon. And one of the important ones is Ahutahi. Okay.
Yes, Ahutahi is the son of the sun. So he's the most sacred star in the sky. He's sometimes Ahutahi, sometimes Altahi. It's the same star. He was so important. His mana was so great that when the waka was taken up into the sky, Tamatarereji's waka, and then tipped out, he had to have a separate spot, because if he had been with the other stars, he would have wiped them all out. You never sat down where a chief sat for the reason that you were breaking tapu.
That's right.
Yeah, so you couldn't have him where everybody else was, so he has to be separate.
So Ahutahi, which is a star which we would know as Canopus, is a high chief of the southern skies. And that big band of stars along the horizon represents the great waka in the sky. Right? And what you've got is the prow is the fishhook. And then if you go back to the other end, you've got the
stern post.
Stern post, you've got Orion and so on. And at this time, the waka is sitting along the horizon. And then what happens is, in the winter at dawn, Ahutahi pulls up the anchor of the waka, which is the Southern Cross. And the waka then begins its journey across the sky. So the year begins, the season begins, with the sailing of the waka across the sky.
The waka is spoken of as being in the eyebrow of the sky. I love that phrase.
Yes, yeah, yeah. So lots to see up there, folks. So we're going to have another little tiny piece of music, and then we come back and we look at what these things are astronomically.
No.
Okay, folks, you're back with Richard and Kay looking at the night sky. And I thought briefly we should look at some of these objects, what they really are. I know, Kay, were you interested in the stars? Where did that begin?
I think it actually began because I'm interested in ancient histories and what people are trying to say. And when you go back into ancient, trying to decode what a lot of stories about, you inevitably end up finding out about a lot of astronomy and, you know, because that's part of what they were all about. Mm. It was so important.
And the all of these Māori meanings behind the stars.
Yeah, well, the fascinating thing is if you actually translate those ancient names and what they mean, they're, sometimes they're funny, you know. Mm. I remember, you know, the winter time was a time of plenty. We don't think of it that way. We tend to think of Northern Hemisphere, you know, winter, snow, cold, no food. But it was a time of plenty, and one of the stars means to pass wind.
Yes. Well, what we're going to do is have a look now, just briefly before we finish. Let's have a look at the Pleiades. What are they? Well, they're actually a star cluster. There are thousands and thousands of clusters across the sky. All stars are born in clusters. And the Pleiades, what is Matariki, actually contains something over several hundreds of stars. It's about 400 light years away. And when they talk about the seven sisters, well, depending on your eyesight and the clarity of the sky, you can see between five and nine stars. And I'm just going to finish off by picking out my favourite star, which is Pleione. And the reason for that is what really got me into astronomy. This is a very young star spinning on its axis. It's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of times brighter than the sun, and it's spinning so rapidly that it's just about disintegrating. And this star actually fluctuates in brightness. Anyway, we're running out of time now, so what I'm going to have to say is bye everybody, and we'll catch you up in a couple of weeks' time, and we'll look at some of these things in greater detail. Okay,
goodbye people.